From the AM/FM 24/7 radio network, broadcasting from AM and FM stations around the country. Welcome to the Small Business Administration award-winning School for Startups Radio, where we talk all things small business and entrepreneurship. Now, here is your host, the guy that believes anyone can be a successful entrepreneur, because entrepreneurship is not about creativity, risk, or passion, Jim Beach.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another exciting edition of School for Startups Radio. Today is Tuesday, the 13th of April, and we have a cram-packed show today. We're going to have to go ahead and get started. First, we're going to speak with a real estate guy who's discovered a very cool new marketing trick that also happens to be decades old. And then we're going to speak with the marketer that hates marketing. We've got a great show, and we appreciate you being with us. Very excited to introduce my first guest today. He may have all of the pieces figured out. He's leading an exotic lifestyle from the Caribbean. We can be jealous of that. And he's running businesses, really cool entrepreneurial things in the United States virtually. He has one of the largest wholesale companies in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex, which is called COSA Investments. We will ask about that. But more of what he is known for is his real estate. He has a cutting-edge boutique brokerage consisting of some of the best agents out there. And he also has a passion for coaching and mentoring. And he runs an organization called the Multipliers Mastermind. I will not let my wife look at that because she'll consider it just too many good-looking men. And I will never get invited to that, Chris, because my wife wouldn't let me go because there's too
many. I love it.
She doesn't want me there. Anyway, Chris Arnold, welcome to the show from the gorgeous yacht in the Caribbean. How are you doing today?
What's up, buddy? Man, glad to be on. Glad to add some value and talk it up today, man. So let's do it.
All right. So let's come back to the virtual lifestyle later. First, though, let's talk about the real estate. You've got an amazing new marketing tool that works for just about any real estate vertical, right?
Absolutely. The one thing I find in common, doesn't matter what type of real estate you're doing, whether that's fix and flip or, you know, wanting to build a rental portfolio or even all the way down to creative financing, what I observe is we all have one thing in common. And in order to, you know, create those types of deals, we have to generate motivated sellers. It's the one thing we all have in common. And so absolutely, it's a important piece to be able to create channels that provide those discounted properties to do whatever exit strategy we want to do with them.
Okay. So how is radio fitting into that?
So I really like to call radio the marketing channel that everyone knows about, but nobody's using. As soon as I say radio, I know that there's a couple thoughts that run through any audience's head, right? The first one they say is, man, radio. That's been around forever, right? And I have to remind people that yes, it has, and so has your demographic. Because statistically, the average age of a person that we do deals with nationwide in the US are over the age of 50. But people confuse themselves, Jim, as their own avatar. So they say to themselves, well, you know, I stream my music. I got a Spotify subscription, and I go, great. But that's your generation. That's not the people that are actually bringing you these discounted deals. And so once people begin to step back, they're like, oh my gosh, this is the very thing that is getting me in front of that target audience that's over the age of 55. And so that's a key piece. And then, of course, the other one I see that pops up quite a bit is people just kind of really assume that it's not affordable. So they go, man, well, you know, advertise on radio, that's probably like television. You know, you'll probably have to start with a budget, Jim, of like what, like 10 grand a month. And with the way that we buy radio, which is our key piece, we buy radio like we buy real estate at a deep discount in price. It's no different. We're investors. We buy everything at a discount. And so I can tell you that the average radio spend that I see nationwide for people that we have set up is about $1,000 to $2,000 for a radio station, which is cheap. It's less than what most people are spending on direct mail.
For what? What does $1,000 to $2,000 get you?
Yeah. So our philosophy is this. We go into a radio station and we want to advertise 100 times per month. So that is 25 times per week. That is 5 times per day, Monday through Friday. That is high frequency. You don't want to advertise more than 100 times because you're going to cross the saturation point. So when I tell you that it's 1,000 to 2,000 and you ask me what you're getting, you're fundamentally getting 60-second spots at $10 to $20 for 60-second spots.
All right. And that's going to get you, what type of station are you advertising on? What type of radio? Radio means a lot. Is that talk? Is that music? What station?
Yeah, it's very simple. You just back into your demographic. What do your grandparents listen to? They listen to old school country. They listen to that old soft rock, right? They listen to classical music. Again, this isn't rocket science. And what's important to understand is this then means that your radio marketing is actually targeted. This is not a spray and pray model. Again, you know, I don't know if you have kids, Jim, but I'll just assume you do. They don't listen to what you listen to for the most part or what your parents did. So people tend to stay in the lane or the genre of music in which they're raised in. So when you go and you advertise on that soft station, you're not getting a bunch of Taylor Swift fans. You're getting people that are over the age of 55. So this then becomes a very targeted approach to get in front of the demographic. Say that again?
They're Pink Floyd fans, not Taylor Swift.
Exactly. Maybe even a little bit older than that, I find sometimes too.
All right. So what are the ads saying? Is this straight up, hey, I'm buying houses? What is the ad?
Yeah, it's a pain point driven ad. So in a sexy 60-second spot, you know, fundamentally what we're going to come out and we're going to say is, hey, you know, we're private investors. We pay cash, you know, convenient clothes as is, you know, the typical sell that's, you know, in opposition to the retail because people sometimes they don't want a list, right? I got a dilapidated house, right? I want cash. I want as is. Get me out of whatever situation that I'm in. And so with that, our ad talks about the fact do you own a junkie house? Do you own a house that's behind on repairs? Are you a landlord that's tired of being a tenant? And we fundamentally know about the 8 different reasons in which people will call in to sell a house, those motivating factors. And so our ad is simply laying those out and letting them know that we've got a solution for them. So someone riding down the road hears that, they call in, you know, go, you know what, Jim, I'm a landlord, man. I'm actually sick of managing my tenants and toilets. Why don't you take this handful of properties I have off my plate? They're yours. Let's start talking about, see if we can make a deal. That's how simple it works.
And how do you buy your radio ads? Do you go station to station or do you buy from a syndicator?
No, this is, we're completely removing the middleman. So what I have found is that even a lot of times when you go to a media buyer, they don't understand this concept. And the best way I can drive this point home is it would be like going to a retail agent, your traditional agent, and telling them that you want to buy 20 properties at 70 cents on the dollar. They can't fathom that, even as an agent, because they're so used to selling the traditional American a retail property. So what I find with media buyers is they might go in and get you 5 to 10% discount, but what we're doing is we're buying roughly around 25 cents on the dollar. And that's what's giving us such a long-term and such a consistent ROI on radio.
But again, you buy that, you say you get rid of the middleman, so you buy it directly from
the station. So we're calling the sales rep that represents that station. Doesn't matter if it's iHeart or CBS or whoever. And we're speaking with a rep and we're beginning at that level and that rep we're negotiating through. So it's their responsibility to represent the station. But again, they work for the station. They're not a media buyer. That is usually the person that stands between you and the station, whether that be TV or radio.
Right. And then do you buy a particular, how well do you research the stations and try to nail that? So for example, you know, here in Atlanta, you can get WSB, which is one of the strongest, largest stations in the country. But I know their ad rates are hundreds of dollars a minute, you know, their normal rate. I can't imagine you could get that for 10 or 20 cents on the dollar. But on the other hand, you know, the Sandy Springs station here, I bet you could get it $10 before a discount, you know, the ads.
No, we're buying good stations. And again, I'm giving you an average spend. If sure. you go up, you can end up paying $30, $40, but we're talking about high level stations at that point, ones that are much bigger. But, you know, to kind of go back to the original question that you were asking me on, you know, how we're going in and actually negotiating that and sizing up those stations is we're pulling data. So here's what most people do. Let me give you the typical road. I want to advertise on radio. Great. So I'm going to call a station. I'm going to speak with a rep, and they are going to send me what's known as a media packet. And I'm going to take a look at that media packet, and the sales rep is going to give me guidance and tell me what their station is worth. What we do is we go in and we get access to Nielsen, which is fundamentally like the multiple listing service for houses, but Nielsen is that for radio, and we pull data. We pull everything to how many people on your station own versus rent. How many people on your station listening are over the age of 50? What is the average median household income of your listenership? Because Nielsen really provides all of that data. So when we call a rep, we don't ask for a media packet. We say, we fundamentally have run comps on your station, and this is what your station is worth. Now, you want to make a rep fall back, you start throwing out words like, I looked at your ranker, your hour by hour report. They don't get those calls, Jim. And so all of a sudden they're like, what? Like, I have not had a call like this before. And the price that we're buying is always the same formula. So it's not like we're just coming in and going at a discount. Our formula is based on the actual data that we pulled on a station. So it's no different than running comps on a house. A house is worth what it's worth because of comps. A radio station is worth what it is because of the comps on it. So they want you to think it's got all these great things, but if you get in and look at the data, you realize that it's primarily being overpriced. But people don't know this. They don't know any better.
Very interesting. So what do you think your ROI or, I don't know, if you run 100 spots, how many calls do you get? How do you measure how successful this is, and what kind of number does that look like?
Yeah, it's not think, it's know. We track absolutely everything. Everything's a mathematical game, right? This is a podcast for business entrepreneurs. KPIs and metrics should drive all decision-making. So again, the number one metric that matters, again, you can track cost per acquisition, cost per lead, et cetera. Those things are great, but they tend to fluctuate. What matters is what would be referred to as your dollar per dollar return. So again, if you're a newer entrepreneur, the best way to simplify that math is for every dollar that I spend on marketing, how many dollars are coming back in profit? And again, I've been advertising on radio for 10 years, so our data is a lot of data. And I find you're always going to run somewhere around $3 to $4, which means that you're going to triple to quadruple your investment, which is fantastic. If you talk to any CFO and they were to size up your marketing channels, they'll tell you that 1 to 3 to 1 to 4 is great. That's right where you want to be. And so you're looking about a 1 to 3 to 1 to 4 return on radio. Now, that's not just in my market. We've helped people set this up in just about every state in the U.S. at this point. And so now I have all that data, and it's $3 to $4. Sometimes I'd see higher in smaller markets because, again, it's so much less expensive to advertise in some rural area than it is, let's say, in Dallas, Fort Worth, or Miami, or Phoenix, or Cali. But all said and done, I see about a $3 to $4 return consistently. And that's the most important part. Consistent. It doesn't fluctuate up and down like direct mail does. Again, I'm picking on direct mail today, but I've had marketing channels that they go up and down like a roller coaster, depending on competition, saturation, you know, what's going on in the whole mail world, costs like pay-per-click can go up and down. Radio is tried and true, $3 to $4 consistently.
Well, Chris, I do want to move on to another topic, so I want to wrap up the radio. I will say one thing to just collaborate what you're saying from my perspective. This is a radio show. I don't know if you know this. This is not a podcast. You're on an actual radio show here. We're on 25 AM FM stations. Of course, we have a podcast version too, but primarily we think of ourselves as a radio show. We are sponsor driven, and our sponsors are more likely to sponsor us because they are older than 50-year-olds making the decision, and to them, radio still makes sense because of Arbitron and because of the Nelson ratings and all the things you're talking about, whereas podcasts don't have that, and they have no clue what is actually defendable in the numbers there. So we have a better success ratio with getting sponsors because of radio, not podcast. So your final thoughts on radio before we switch over to virtual living.
You know, the only thing I would say is, you know, a couple last benefits, you know, for those that might be listening going, you know, man, I've really been trying to figure out that next channel that I want to utilize. I think the two best things that you get with radio outside of what we talked about is celebrity status and instant credibility. I mean, Jim, you know this, you have a radio show. So if somebody sees you out and about or hears your name, you're like, oh, Jim, that's a guy on the radio I hear, right? So that is the power and the psychology behind mass media being television and radio. And now obviously you have social media. And so I just find that it's incredible for building your brand because to the people over the age of 50, and you proved my point right here because you already said it, they trust radio. They trust what's said on the radio. They were raised in a culture that you trusted what you heard for the most part. And so when you go in to do a deal with someone that calls off radio, you're already way down the know you like, you trust you path, which is a lot better than starting where you're at when you're doing a spam-based approach like text blasting or ringless voicemail, et cetera. So that'd be my last thought. I think because that's a massive benefit for sure.
All right. Tell us about your virtual lifestyle. I was teasing you about living on a boat. Apparently you actually like land. How do you manage from far away? What are the pieces that are the hardest to overcome not actually being at the office?
We don't have an office. We are not a brick and mortar organization, although we started that way. I can tell you my first step into virtual world was one in which I was nervous. I couldn't really comprehend how you built culture and how you, you know, created meaningful relationships or, you know, even fundamentally manage people that weren't in an office, you know, within four walls every day. But that has been completely blown out of the water. I find that the people I have, particularly virtually, tend to be very self-motivated, very self-managed. And so what I can tell you, just based on my overall experience of, you know, going the actual virtual route, I prefer at this point, not just because I live in Tulum and in the Caribbean, I'd rather lead a team virtually all day than office. Because you remove the drama. I don't have people fighting over who drank my Diet Coke in the fridge or who left the toilet seat up. Right? I mean, it's the silly things that people get upset about in an office space. So, you know, once I overcame my misconceptions and realized that a lot of my thinking was backwards, it was pretty much off to the races at that point. So what I would tell most people is once you step into virtual world, really the only thing you probably hold you back is you probably have some things you need to unlearn about what you perceive about running virtual companies.
All right. I can understand management from far away because I do that. That's not a problem. But culture and relationships, how are you building a culture for people that you've never met and don't know what Tulum looks like? How does that happen?
Yeah, I have found that not meeting someone face-to-face does not affect the depth of the relationship. I really have learned that. And I'm not going to say that there's not value in meeting someone, but I'm going to give you an example. I have a chief operating officer. Again, we have a few companies that we run. And I trust her with my life. I trust her with my finances. I trust her, you know, with my businesses. And I have never to this day met her face to face. And so what I learned is that this whole concept of can you build deep, meaningful relationships, you know, via Zoom and via phone calls, you absolutely can. And so what that's required and what creates meaningful relationships is simply quality time. So in my company, again, we run EOS models, scaling up. We have great meeting rhythms in which we run our organization. So I'm interacting with the people in my company on a daily basis. And so you generate that amount of talk time year after year, you become pretty tight. And we do some practical stuff. So I'll give a practical nugget. You know, we have a great text thread. And we're always goofing off on that text thread. The one that we have is actually, we have one rule and that's allowed not to be business. So, you know, we'll do things like every Wednesday, we'll throw out some, you know, silly questions, something that would reveal, you know, something about people's lives, you know, whether they take a picture of something in their house and they send it in and everyone tries to guess who in the world, you know, has that object in their house, just different things like that. So I found that you can work around that by utilizing something as basic as playing games, you know, via WhatsApp in a text thread. So I'm actually, in my opinion, this is actually a true statement. I feel that my culture virtually, and this is true, honestly, is deeper than the culture that I had in the office. Because here's what I'm going to tell you. It's pretty easy to be in an office and not really have to interact. Right. But when you're virtual, it requires a higher level of communication to pull things off because it's more difficult to do things a lot of times virtually than if you're just together. So what I have found because of that is it's actually tightened the community more because we have to communicate more to run businesses without brick and mortar because we're not just in an office together anymore.
You said it started off with office. How much of the virtual community now knew each other in person in an office environment prior?
At this point, less than 10%.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Because, and I'll tell you why, and this is important to understand. I truly believe it is difficult to take an in-office employee who has been raised in structure and is used to showing up on time and to be held accountable and move them to virtual world. I find a lot of times they flounder. So my staff has primarily been hatched and raised in virtual world. And that is an entirely different person because usually you're dealing with, for example, you're dealing with sometimes a lot of women, right? I'd say that the majority of my company is women. They tend to have military husbands. You know, they are taking care of kids and having a career. Maybe they're a single mom. They don't have the luxury to drive into an office. They can't. So they were forced years ago to figure out this whole virtual world in order to really create the lifestyle that they needed to wear all of these hats. And so that goes back to my point that I find people raised in that world are more driven, you know, more disciplined, more motivated than I ever found people that were coming into my office. Those people had to be managed because they were raised in structure. What I find is if you, and again, it's always the right people. You can hire bad people. It doesn't matter what we're talking about. But if you hire the right virtual people, I'm amazed. They require very little management overall is what I found, if you have the right people.
Well, it's an interesting thesis. I will think about that as I look at how certain employees react to going back and not going back. Both my wife and I are home now forever, I think. You would have, we'll quit before we would go back to a job in the office. So it'll be interesting to see how the rest of the world responds.
Now, people are going to have to learn quickly, right? Virtual world has been forced. And so, you know, it's either pleasure or pain, right? That causes people to have to change. And so, you know, I don't think a lot of people even knew what Zoom was. I don't think there's a person now you talk to that doesn't know what Zoom is. So the world has mandated that we become more virtual. And I think you're going to see a large shift with the change and, you know, everything that's happened via COVID, which I don't think is necessarily a bad thing. It just pushes people. Again, virtual is tech. To run virtual, you have to be more tech savvy. And we are obviously living in a world in which tech is doubling every 2 years. So in some ways, I think it's good that we're being forced now to really embrace tech. So it doesn't matter if you're a, you know, 65-year-old grandpa, you know, you might now have to know how to use Zoom. That's not necessarily a bad thing because people got to be on track with where tech's going and not get left behind.
I think it's a great thing. My little 5-year-old was born within 2 days of another 5-year-old that we've grown up with. And so they are best friends since, you know, before birth, they have been best friends. And I saw them the other day discussing Zoom versus Teams, and they disagreed. One was a Zoom girl and the other was a Teams girl. And I thought the, you know, seeing 5-year-olds discuss Zoom versus Teams is an embodiment of the time we're in. So
yes, things are changing for sure.
Chris, how do we find out more about you? Follow you online, all of that, please.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, if you listen, and again, I'm Been there, done that. It's always great to just get access to, you know, free information and content. So you can always check out the YouTube channel that we have, which is Chris Arnold Real Estate. And over there, we interview a lot of people that have utilized radio. Again, that's one of the things that I coach and I help with. And if you're listening, you're like, man, this radio piece is kind of interesting. I'd like to get more information on that. You can just go to wholesalinginc.com/REI radio. Again, wholesalinginc.com/REI radio, and book a call. See potentially if your market's open. As always, do due diligence. Make sure something's a great fit for you before you ever pull the trigger. So that's it.
Very great. Thank you so much. And enjoy the surf, the sailing, the yachting, the hydroboarding, whatever activity y'all are doing. What's your favorite water activity? Scuba. Please be scuba.
Mine's paddle surfing, man. So I live in Tulum. We don't have big waves, but we do have enough waves that you can go out on a paddleboard and actually surf. So I love paddle surfing.
And we will be right back.